if it does, you can keep retrying. I don't know what to tell you. Anyway, so there was this, we talked about, I don't know who's here every week, but last week I mentioned that we had this group of kids, some placed in Somerset, who had a bake sale for Ukraine. And the hospital that was going to take the proceeds from that never got back with them, which really discouraged the kids because they're trying to do something, you know. And so two people who knew of us was there at a prayer meeting and said, oh, we know somebody. They're all about Ukraine. They can get it to you. So anyway, we went up there this past week to meet with them. So the organization that we met with is actually called the Broderhof. Broderhof? Haus. Haus? Hof. Hof. Anyway. It means Brotherhood House, I think. They actually started in Germany right before Hitler came to power in the early, late 30s, early 40s. And when Hitler came to power, they realized they had to leave. So they left and England took them in. But after the war started, the English countryside was a little bit nervous about this German group of people living. And they are a commune. I mean, I guess our definition of commune, that's what they are. And you know, the way they describe it, they're trying to live like they did in the first and second chapter of Acts, where all the Christians came together. They pulled all the resources. They lived together. They worshiped together. They worked together. That was it. Of course, they thought Jesus was coming back any day now, and it would be several months before they realized, oh, when he said soon, he meant soon on heaven's time. Anyway, so, but they're community, they call it, but we would call them a commune. They all live there, but they're not separatists. It's not like the Amish or anything. They obviously knew about the Ukrainian war. They have all electricity, internet, all those things. They do have certain clothing restrictions. All the women were wearing ankle-length skirts made of gingham material. No makeup, no jewelry. Most women had their hair pulled back. Many were wearing like babushkas. But like the guy who let us in was wearing a Dodge Ram T-shirt, but it was black and kind of understated, you know. So it seems to be, you know, some of the stuff's okay. But again, you know, they have cars. In fact, they have a factory, and all the men work in the factory. Their factory, they create like commercial level handicap equipment, and apparently it does very well. It's some kind of pretty good operation, and they work there. That's how they raise money for the community mainly. And they have two communities on both sides of Route 40 in Somerset. Like, if you're going to Ohio Powell, you've probably passed by their gates before. It's amazing. And back when they first moved in, they bought a hotel with 120 acres that had failed, and they moved in there. And then they got so big, they created a second. They bought 67 acres across the way. And the state actually built them their own tunnel underneath Route 40 so they could connect the two communities. That would never be done today, but that was done back in the day. And so anyways, it was really interesting. We had a chance to meet with them. The kids that we're talking about are third through fifth grade. They have their own school. They have school up until high school. High school, they all go to a high school in New York. It's a boarding school that they own. And then after that, the kids go on to college, regular colleges. But anyway, so we were meeting the third through fifth graders, and I'll tell you what, these kids' faces just shone. It was like brightness coming from them. It was really, really something. All the girls, of course, wearing their gingham dresses, and they had their hair in braids, you know, and in the back, and the guys were all wearing, you know, but they were just attentive and polite and very interested in what we were saying. We went up with Jared Younger. I don't know if any of you met him. He comes Saturday nights and usually at the fellowship dinners. He was a Passover as well. His story is he's a Messianic Jew, but his father was shot and killed in the Tree of Life shooting. And so he moved back to Pittsburgh over that. So he gave his testimony a little bit. I did a little talking, and then Victoria spoke of what's going on in Ukraine. Very interesting. Now, they said that they had hundreds of people show up for their bake sale, and they raised close to $3,000. They had hundreds of people showing up, and they just posted up on Facebook and put posters up around town. That's all they did. And they said they couldn't believe it. And every kid had to take a turn, you know, manning the bake sale booth. And they were there for, I forget, 8 hours or something, so they kept changing shifts out. I asked how many people came, and one of the girls said thousands. And the teacher said hundreds. But, you know, still a lot of people came. And, you know, you don't raise $3,000 on cupcakes unless you sell a lot of cupcakes. And anyway, but they were just, so we opened up for questions. We were all done. The only question they want to know is how many people do you think our proceeds are going to feed. They're really just very concerned about the children. And so we promised them we'd send them some pictures. They can put it on a bulletin board. They're excited about that. And then we were invited to join them for lunch, which took place. The whole community eats together in this very, very large, almost like an auditorium, but there were no seats in it. Almost like a maybe gymnasium or cafeteria, I guess. But, you know, open concept and family style, you know, tables up and everybody sat, the families, we sat with like the leader of the group in that area. And then right before they said the grace for the prayer, they announced the song they were going to sing. And they all broke into this song. I didn't know it. It sounded almost like a Swedish song. I mean, it's English words, but it almost sounded like a Swedish-based song because it had a kind of that lilt to it. But man, alive, can they sing. I mean, there were several hundred people there, probably 300 people or something. Pitch perfect, a cappella, all in the same time, everything. It was sharp and crisp. I mean, they could have been a choir. And just people sitting around eating. Just amazing. And I turned to Andrew, the guy who was kind of our liaison there at that time. He's sort of the leader of the group. And I said, your people can sing. He said, well, we're third generation by now. And everybody in school goes through choir. And so they know them all. I said, man, I'm coming to their Christmas show this year. This is going to be, can you imagine? But just wonderful people. And the whole time we were there, like, you know, it was a pretty long lunch because they had us speak again. And their kids had, they're almost ready to go to high school. So I guess middle school kids had gone to D.C. on a field trip. And they gave their little report on it. So that took a long time. Thus, you know, we spoke. So I don't know how long we were there. Over an hour. Not one peep from the kids. You wouldn't have known there were kids there. I mean, nobody crying, nobody whining. Nobody complaining about the food. Of course, everybody ate the same food, right? It was just like, wow, this is a different world. It really is. I mean, it takes a community, I guess. But just a really, yeah. She says when she buries me, she's moving there. But anyway, it is a commune. I mean, you own nothing. Everybody has housing. Yeah, but they have like apartment or, you know, what condos, whatever you call them, but they're assigned by the community. And your place in that community is decided by the community. In other words, when they moved across Route 40, the community told the people who were going to go across Route 40. And they're opening up communities all over, actually. They went from there to England, to Paraguay, and then they came to the United States. Through the Mennonites, actually helped them, which was weird because they're not affiliated, but the Mennonites helped them. And then they went back, where's the guy, Switzerland or someplace, Netherlands, they're starting another one. And a guy was there setting that up. When they started, the community will say, you, you need to go there. And that's it. Your family picks up and goes where they send you. Which, you know, went not too bad. They send you to England. Paraguay would be a rough road, though. I think it's still a little bit primitive there. If you wanted to go visit your relatives or something, if you had relatives who, you know, weren't part of the community, like kids maybe, you have to ask permission to leave. Because, you know, you're going to be off work. You also have to permission to use the car. You have to sign it out. You know, all those things. Because you own nothing. Everything's owned by the community. It is the way it was in the Book of Acts. Although, what I didn't bother mentioning was, you know, persecution came and God split them up. But that is how it starts out in the Book of Acts. It was a great time. We enjoyed it so much. And they said, you guys have to come back. They loved Victoria, even though she was wearing jeans. And makeup and jewelry. But I mean, nobody shunned us. They all came up, you know, no one thought bad of us because, you know, we were living with the Gentiles. It was a great time. So anyway. Yeah, you can see Nemacolon from it. Yeah, it's something springs. Yeah, and there's a gate there. That's them. That's their community. That's the second community. There's a tunnel and it goes across. If you can see the first community from there as well. Yep. Fayette, maybe. I always consider it Somerset, but you're right, it's probably Fayette. Anyway, yeah, pretty, pretty cool. So if we go back up again, and we'll tell you guys when we go, if anyone wants to go with us. They have Bible study on Tuesdays. That's how Ty and Jared knew of them. But they've invited us up. We really had a good time. Afterwards, we went over to Andrew's house, condo, whatever, with he and his wife, and we had coffee and cookies, and by the way, the cookies were great.
quick.
Yeah, and we had a great time. I mean, we just conversated. It reminded me a lot of sitting down and talking to my grandfather back in the day, you know, of his stories about growing up in Egypt and all that kind of stuff. It was just to hear Andrew's story, because he'd been there for a long time. He'd been to Paraguay and riding bareback horses in Paraguay and all that stuff. It was pretty cool. So anyway, all right. So would you, having said all that, I got to get the order of the service down somehow, because this doesn't seem to flow. But we're going to go to the pastoral prayer now, if you would all join me in prayer. Our gracious and heavenly Father, each one of us today stands before you as a person who is broken. We are broken by sin, yes, but we are also broken by the effects of sin, by living in a world that has been perverted by sin. We are broken by pain, both physical and emotional, by sickness, by trials, by trauma, and by losses. We are broken. And in our brokenness, we come to you, remembering your promise that you will not break a bruised reed and you will not quench a smoldering wick. Remind us, Lord Adonai, of your unfailing love for us. Help us believe that we have nothing to fear from you. We can come to you small, weak, and broken, knowing you'll receive us and not turn us away. You'll help us, you'll care for us, because you are a great God and you are a good God. We know that our brokenness does not make us useless to your purposes. We know that through this you can display your goodness, your power, your glory. You say, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and we answer, that's us. We are weary and we are weighed down. You tell us that your special blessing is upon those who are poor in spirit, who are meek and mournful, and we feel hope because we are poor and sorrowful and mournful, and we come looking for the grace of your blessing. You tell us that you deliberately choose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise, and you choose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. And this too is us, Lord. Much of the time we are foolish. We are not strong in the world's eyes. We are not regarded in the world as great or powerful or mighty. So please, Lord, use us to showcase your wisdom and to display your strength. Father, it is our desire to bring glory to your name. And so we submit ourselves to your purposes. You are the creator. We are the created. You are the potter. We are the clay. If we can best bring glory to you through our weakness, then we say, take our strength. If we can best bring glory to you through poverty, we say, take our riches. If we can best bring glory to you through loss, then we say, take what we have. Take what we love. Take what we cling to, because we can lose everything in this world, Lord, but not you. With the psalmist, we cry out, create in me a clean heart, God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. We cling to your promise that you will work all things for good and for your glory for those who are called according to your purpose. So we bring you the mess of the lives that we have made, and we ask that you redeem them to make something beautiful out of them that brings us good and you glory. Work our weaknesses for gain, our losses for good. Work our brokenness for proof of your redemption. Lord, we come before you now with these special requests that have been laid upon our hearts, that we may lay them before your cross. We do lift up Ukraine. Lord, we pray that you'll continue to keep everyone safe who's doing your work there. We pray for our brothers and sisters at the Karasen Church of Christians. We also pray for Mark Priam in Odessa with his family. They're busily doing your work the best they can. Lord, we pray for their protection. Supernaturally protect them, Lord. And Lord, you know we also have been providing for them so they can continue their work, and we're not sure how that's going to happen now. We need to get through to them, so we need you to fix the things that are broken there so that we can once more send them funds so they can continue buying food and medicine and helping the people there. Lord, we also lift up young Sakone to you. We still pray for healing from her for the tumors. We also pray that Ty and Gloria got home for the mission trip safely. We lift up Beverly for her pain in her hip. And Lord, we pray for Debbie's continued healing in her knee. Be with these people, Lord, and the ones we don't even know about, but you know the concerns and the needs of the people. Before we even ask, you know our needs. But we come, Lord, asking for you to provide. Lord, we know that often green pastures lay beyond dark valleys, and we will follow you there, even into the valley of the shadow of death. As long as our shepherd is with us, we go faithfully. For if you are with us, even if everything else is taken away, we still will lack nothing, because the Lord is our shepherd, and we will not want. We pray that you would use us to glorify yourself. Use us, Lord, just as we are, little, weak, and broken, whatever it takes, whatever it costs. We pray only that you would receive the glory. Holy Spirit, take over this service. Let your words be spoken as you bring us heart to heart with the living God. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And we have some scripture, but my microphone is still sounding weird to me. I don't know. I'm going to bring it back a little bit more. I'm sorry. I don't know. Last night it didn't sound bad, but tonight it sounds weird. Okay. I'm not used to hearing my consonants pop like that. All right. So this is actually from Isaiah 42:1. Behold, says the Lord, my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the Gentiles. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoking wick he will not quench. Thus says God the Lord, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the dungeons. Behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declare. Sing to the Lord a new song, and his praise from the ends of the earth. Okay. And that's it. I want to... Yeah, but these are repeats. So, oh, nope, that's it. Okay. Tomorrow, women's group, grief share, Bible study, fellowship dinner. We all know those things, and we'll be back in touch on the next fellowship dinner, but spoiler alert, it'll be in July now, right? Yeah. This will be May. We'll skip June, July. Every other month, first Friday of the month, you guys can start planning yourselves accordingly. Sometime, I hope, late July, sometime in August, again, still trying to work it out, do a picnic for the church. It'll be a bring a friend to church picnic day. And I'm trying to see if we can rent some kind of a portable swimming pool and do baptisms. So we'll see. I don't know. It's a lot to ask, but Pastor Mark has to get going. All right, so we're on the second week now of the series on David. This is week number 2 in the Renegade series.
Oh, mama, I'm in fear for my life from the long arm of the law. Lawmen is putting into my running, and I'm so far from my home. Oh, mama, I can hear you a-crying. You're so scared and all alone. Hangman is coming down from the gallows, and I don't have very long.
So mystery solved somehow. That was subwoofer got kicked up. Wow, about blew me out of here when that bass started. I could just, I'm gonna get kicked out. All right, so we are on this. This is week 2. We have 3 weeks before we actually get to the star of the show, which is David. But last week, we kind of set the stage before where we were in the kingdom. And this week, we're going to talk about, in fact, the next 2 weeks, we're going to talk about the first king of Israel, a guy named Saul. So we're moving through this. It's a 12-week series. I actually know all these things because this is a repeat of something I did in 2014, reruns already. Okay, but we're going to talk about the first king of Israel. And I wanted to spend a little time on him because he usually gets skipped over. It's like, oh, Saul was this really bad king, and he was there first. He was kind of a mistake, and God replaced him with David, and everybody was happily, you know, lived happily ever after. It's not at all the way the story goes. But I want to show you, actually, in kind of the beginning video, did a good job describing this. Saul was given exactly the same opportunities to be a good king, a great king, as David. He's given everything by God to succeed. And you're going to see that this week. And yet, eventually, we'll see him go off the rails. So, King Saul. And if you remember last week, where it was the people said, hey, we want to have a king. They hadn't had a king up until now because God was their king. And so they came to Samuel and said, look, we want a king. And he tried to talk them out of it. They wouldn't listen to it. And so finally, the Lord says, go ahead, give them what they want. Give them a king. So Samuel goes to the people and says, okay, everyone go back to your own town. We're going to select the first king of Israel. So the question is, how do you select a king? And the answer is, of course, we know because we have the stories. But before I get to that, I would want to just point out one thing. The people came to Samuel to speak to God and said, we want a king. Now, I just kind of emphasize that because that's typically how we go to the Lord in prayer. I mean, think about it. How much of your prayer is telling God what you want? I mean, that's almost what prayer is, right? I want this, I want that, I want this. I'm going to come to God, and I'm going to tell him what I want. And we always go when we do that. But the problem with telling God what we want is that sometimes he actually gives it to us. And we need to be careful about this, because what we actually do is we come to God because, you know, we've spent some time in church, and for those Reformed Catholics, CCD, and for those Protestants among us, Bible school and Sunday school. And we have learned that you don't just come to God and tell him what you want. No. You make God try to believe it's a good thing. We try to convince him of it. We do this every time we pray. If someone comes for healing, you know, we have prayer meeting coming up next Friday. We have prayer meetings. People come for healing, and we all gather around. We place hands on them. We pray for them. And the prayers always go something like this. Lord, you know this person. They're a good person. See, we're trying to convince God there's a reason why he should give us the healing. This is a good person. They come to church. They love you. They brush their teeth every night. They are a good person, Lord. And therefore, I'm going to ask that you heal them, and you're going to do it because it's a good thing. And it doesn't matter what it is. Whatever we want, we try to convince God, okay, I'm about to ask you for something that's going to seem like a big ask, but I'm going to convince you that it's good. And usually, God in his mercy says, I'm not doing that. But sometimes God actually gives us what we ask for. And that's a problem because oftentimes we think that's a blessing and it is not. A lot of the worst things that ever happened to me in my life happened after I got what I wanted. So what are you supposed to do instead? Well, actually, if you read the scriptures, the servant asks God what he needs instead. And in fact, the first part of prayer should be, God, I'm going to ask you for a lot of things that have troubles in my life. But before I do, could you give me an idea of what I really need? Because what Jesus says was, when you come to the Father in prayer, he knows before you ask what you need and will provide it, not what you want. Our prayers would be a lot more successful if we started there. But anyway, getting back to the king, how do you choose a king? Now, if I told you that here in 1 Samuel 8, we're going to talk about how they chose a king, we know the stories from books, and we would expect the next verse to go something like this. And so Samuel took a sword, forged in the depths of Mount Sinai, and with the strength of the Lord upon him, thrust it deep into a stone and said, he who can pull this sword from this stone is born rightwise king of the Jews. I put this up last night, and there was somebody in front row going, I don't remember that verse. No, it's not in the Bible. This is a made up verse. But this is what we'd expect to find next in the Bible. Isn't it going to be something amazing? This is the first king of Israel now. This is historic. God says, yeah, okay, I'll give you the first king. That's fine. I'll give him to you. You ask for him, I'll give him to you. Don't you expect now to something remarkable to happen? How do you choose a king? Well, you've heard of the three wise men, right? That's how we get the King of Israel in the New Testament. That's how Jesus comes. We've heard the story of the three wise men. But this is the first King of Israel in the Old Testament. Let me introduce to you the three donkeys. I'm not making this up. This is how the king is found in Israel. So first we're introduced to him, and this is in 1 Samuel 9. There was a Benjamite whose name was Kish, and he had a son named Saul, as handsome a young man as could be found anywhere in Israel. Well, that's important. If you're going to have a king, he's got to be good looking, right? And he was a head taller than anyone else. That's tall, by the way. I mean, I don't know, because we're talking about not a head taller than some people. You could take the tallest person they knew of in Israel, and he was a head taller than that. Head taller means you're looking there at their Adam's apple. That's a tall person, right? And so he's big. He's very big. He's good looking. That's a king stuff right there. This is what Hollywood would have chosen. Now we get into the story of how he is found. Now, three donkeys belonging to Saul's father were lost. And so Kish said to his son Saul, take one of the servants and you go and look for the donkeys. Now, I want to point out they don't send the servants alone. This is an important job. But I also want to point out they have servants. So Saul's kind of a rich kid. This is perfect. This is great. He's tall. He's good looking. And he comes from money, a little bit of money. That's important, too, because we want him cultured, right? We don't want him to be some kind of crass guy who, you know, sends out mean tweets. We want him to be diplomatic, you know, have gone to school. And this is who this guy is. So they go off and they go looking for him. And we're going to see he is not the brightest guy, you know, he's not the sharpest plow in the field or whatever. I don't know what expression he would use in those days. But he passes through the hill country of Ephraim and through the area around Shalishah, and they don't find them. So these things took off. These three donkeys were amazing. They're gone, and they don't even know where they are. They're donkeys, but they're gone. I used to have Siberian Huskies before I settled on German Shepherds. When I was younger, I had a Siberian Husky. I had two Siberian Huskies briefly, horrible mistake, because Siberian Huskies are sight dogs, which means what they see, they run. They're bred to run, right? And so you like open a door, poof, there he goes. Love you, gotta go. You know, it's like, see you later, takes off. And they will run. They're like, the first time in when you go to the north, the first time they hook them up to sleds, they'll run like 80 miles. It's just like, the boom, they can go. When you get two of them, they challenge each other to how far they can go. So when my two Huskies would get loose, and they always get loose eventually, I had collars on them always with my ID on them, phone number they could call. I would get phone calls from people 15, 20 miles away. Hey, I got your dogs. You know, okay, where are you? Oh, okay. Well, I'll pack a lunch and come and get them. You know, they could run. These donkeys were better. I mean, boom, they're gone. They don't even know. They're going all the way through the land. They come from place to place to place, city to city to city. They go in the district of Shalem, but the donkeys weren't there either. Then they passed through the territory of Benjamin, but they did not find them there. And now they're lost. They took off expecting it. We'll just find the stupid donkeys over the hill. They've gone hither and yon. They still haven't found these stupid donkeys. And they're pretty lost by now. But actually, they're not lost because God is in charge of exactly where they are. They don't know that. They think they're lost. I love what Saul says. He says, the servant is with him. Look, we could go back, and my father's going to stop thinking about donkeys and start worrying about us. And we're pretty lost right now. I'm kind of out here, and I don't have Google Maps. I don't know what's going on. The servant says, no, look, in this town, the servant knew this, there's a man of God here, and he's highly respected, and everything he says comes true. I want to know that man of God, by the way. That's somebody I want to know. So let's go there now, and maybe he can tell us which way to take. And Saul says, well, if we go, what are we going to give him? The food in our sacks are gone. I kind of get the impression that Saul probably ate it all in the first hour. You know, the food's all gone. Probably ate the servants too. He seems like a big guy eating a lot, you know. We don't have any money. We don't have any gift to take him. What am I going to do? And like, servants probably looking at him like, didn't you bring any money? You took off on a trip without enough food and brought $0? Like I said, Saul's not very bright. But the servant says, well, oh, actually, I have a quarter of a shekel. I got a little bit here. Good thing the servant was thinking. Yeah. I'll give it to the man of God, and maybe he'll tell us which way to take. And it lets us know that that's a thing. You used to be able to go to the prophet of God and pay him money. You know, being a prophet doesn't pay well. So they pay him money, and he'd ask God, and God reveal things to him. So they're heading to find him now. And I'm cutting out some of the story because they actually go through a bunch of towns looking for the prophet of God then. And finally some people say, hey, he's right now, you're lucky. He's leading people up to the high place which is what prophets did to sacrifice. And so we know exactly where he's going to be. We don't know where he is, but we know where he's going to be. If you head that way, you will come across him. So they went up to the town, and as they were entering it, there was Samuel. That's the prophet they're looking for, coming towards them on the way up to the high place. What a coincidence. But of course, it's not a coincidence at all. And we know that because now it actually says, now the day before Saul even came, the Lord revealed to Samuel, about this time tomorrow, I'm going to send you a man from the land of Benjamin, and he will be the ruler of my people. He's the next king. He will deliver them from the hand of Philistines because they've cried out and I've heard their cries. So when Samuel sees this big guy coming towards him, he says, the Lord says, yeah, that's the guy I was talking to you about. That one right there. And so Samuel comes to them. You know, he says, I'm the seer. I'm the guy you're looking for. That must have blown their minds, right? And so here's what I want you to do. Just come with me. I'm going up to the high place right now to offer, and these families are coming with me. Come with me and eat with me, and I'll send you off in the morning. I'll tell you everything that's in your heart. And oh, by the way, those donkeys that wandered away, they've already been found. So this is really great because God's not only providing all this, he's also saying, don't worry about them, because I know you think your dad's going to be mad, but he's not going to be mad. And then Samuel shifts into rabbinical speak. And this is kind of weird for us, but rabbis ask questions. They don't make statements, right? And when I say that, I mean they try to provoke thought through their questions. I don't mean like my wife's question, is that your underwear on the floor? Because that's not really trying to provoke thought. Because I'm thinking, it better be my underwear on the floor, actually. We got a lot of questions coming right now, but that's not to provoke thought, right? That's just another way of saying the same thing. Get your underwear off the floor. The rabbis would actually ask questions to provoke thought. And so here's what he says. He says, who does all of Israel desire but you and your father's family? And Saul's looking at him like, this man's out of his mind. And he may be a seer, but he's a little crazy, a little bit touched in the head. He says, I'm a Benjaminite. He actually answers in a question, which so shows he was trained. But he says, I'm a Benjaminite from the smallest of Israel's tribe, and my clan's the least important of all the clans. Why would you say something like that to me? I'm the least of the smallest clan of the smallest tribe. Israel's not looking for me. I'm looking for donkeys. And Samuel says, no, that's not true. But here's what I want you to do. Come with me. So he takes him and his servant, and they go to the banquet hall in the high place where they're going to be offering the sacrifice. And Samuel takes the cook aside and says, hey, remember that guy I said would be coming? And I told you to set aside the choice part of the meat for him? He's here now. That's for him. And so they come and they bring him food. And there's a spot at the table, like with his name on it. He says, I want you to notice that the reserved piece is set before you. This is the part we saved for the king. I knew you were coming. Eat. It was safe for you for the solemn event. And we invite these people. So Saul ate with Samuel that day. And then they go back down from the high place, and there was a bed for him. By the way, got a bed for you. Get a good night's sleep. Tomorrow we got to talk. Right? And in the morning, he wakes him up. He says, wake up that I may send you on your way. And Saul rose, and both he and Samuel went out into the street. And as they were going out to the outskirts, Samuel said to Saul, you can send your servant on home. You won't need him anymore for what he has to do from now. You can go and send him on here, but I want you to stop yourself with me for a little while because I need to make you understand the word of the Lord. I have for you a message from God, and I need to make the word of the Lord known to you. Stick a pin in that. We'll be back because I want you to see that he's saying God's word will be revealed to you. Now, we have another word for that, right? But he's saying God's word is going to be revealed to you. And we'll talk more about this because what's going on in Saul's life, and I want you to catch this because I get this a lot, especially when I'm in the Old Testament. People look at me like, okay, cool story, bro, but how does it apply to me? Pretty sure I'm not going out here and becoming king of anything, right? King or queen. I'm not going to do it. So how does this apply to me? I want you to see that Saul is you. Because God comes to you in the same way he's coming to Saul. And what Saul is being called to is a pretty big ministry. king of all Israel. That's a big ministry. But the pattern is the same no matter what ministry you're being called to. You are being called to some ministry because God doesn't like spectators. He wants people working for the kingdom. You will be called to a ministry. It might seem small to you, but the pattern is exactly the same. And we're going to come back to that. Because after God's word is revealed, this happens. Samuel takes a flask of oil and pours it over his head and says, "The Lord has anointed you as commander of his people." Notice he never calls him king, commander. He's going to be leading them out, leading them in. "When you have departed from me today, you're going to have two men come up to you and tell you, 'We found your donkeys,' because I want you to know those are no longer your concern. Donkeys don't matter to you. You can put them out of your mind entirely. So you can wear that. And then what's going to happen is you're going to go forward and you're going to meet a group of prophets coming down from their high place. And they will be prophesying. And I'm just going to try not scare, because I know we have some former Baptists in the room as well. They're talking about speaking in tongues. We saw them by prophesying. They're going to be coming down. They're going to be speaking in tongues. Where that's when the Holy Spirit comes over you and you just start speaking. You start saying things you don't even know you're saying. Now, that can be in your own language. Some prophecy comes out in your language. But a real true prophet won't necessarily even know what he said. They'll have to ask somebody else, "What did I say?" Because the Holy Spirit's taken over them. And this is speaking in tongues. So he says, they're going to come down and they're going to start prophesying. And the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you. Watch out. And you will prophesy with them. And you will be turned into a different man. And let that be. When these signs come to you, that you do as the occasion demands. Don't fight it. Don't resist it. Go with it. Let the Spirit take you. So what we're seeing here is God's idea of a king. And this is exactly, I mean, obviously not each individual steps including the donkeys, but these three main points he's going to do with David. This is how God raises up a king. He does these things. The first thing he does, he's going to bring them to the word of God. Now, the word of God is going to turn him aside from his path. See, Saul had a path he was on. I'm going to find donkeys. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm on a mission to find donkeys. And the word of the Lord comes and says, "No, you're not." And the word of the Lord turns him away from finding donkeys. That's not your job anymore, right? Now, the word of the Lord comes to you as well. And you're living your life and you come face to face with the Lord, word of the Lord, and the whole idea of the word of the Lord is to turn you around. In fact, the word we use for that is repentance. Now, repentance sounds like this really big, complicated things, but here's literally what repentance means. I'm walking this way, and the word of the Lord comes to me, and I repent, and I walk this way instead. That's literally what repentance means. It means turning away from the way you were going and go the way God sent you. That's the first step, right? But we can see that in a Christian's life. You don't get to the second step unless you do that. You keep walking for yourself. You may be looking at God, you know, but you're still going your way. You haven't repented. You haven't changed a thing. A lot of people wonder, "Well, I know all about God, but I don't see any changes." Yeah, because you're still walking for you. You're still going down the same path you've always gone down. You live for yourself like you've always lived. But then comes God's anointing, which empowers him, in this case Saul, but also you, to live a new life. That's the Holy Spirit. Because you can't do that alone, and God knows that, so he gives you the Holy Spirit. We call that redemption. God takes your life and redeems it. And he's speaking right now. You can hear Man of the Thunder. He's like, "Pay attention, folks. Don't make me send lightning." And then finally, God's Spirit changes his heart. He's going to make you a new person. That's called righteousness. Turn you from the way you were going, anoint you with the Holy Spirit, and make you a new person, makes you righteous. This is what Saul had an opportunity to be. And then we're going to see in 3 weeks or 2 weeks, that's what David gets. The difference is Saul never fully repents. He never really buys into all this. And we'll talk more about that next week. So, here's what's funny. We see this, that God has chosen his king. It's going to be Saul. But he did it in private, as he will often call you into ministry in private. So now he has announced this to the world. But how's he going to do that? Is he just going to walk out with Samuel and say, "Hey, Samuel, just bring him out, Saul, let everybody see"? No. He's going to make it seem like it was random chance. God cracks me up when he does this stuff. So Samuel calls all the people together, brings them to Mizpah, said the children of Israel, thus says the Lord God of Israel, I brought Israel up out of Egypt and delivered you from the hand of the Egyptians and from the hand of all kingdoms and from all those who oppressed you. But you rejected me. And so you said, set a king over us. Therefore, present yourselves before the Lord by your tribes and by your clans. So they divvy up, first by tribes and then inside the tribes by clans. And God's prophet is going to go and select the tribe. Well, we know which tribe it is. It's the tribe of Benjamin. But no one else knows that but Samuel. How's he going to do it? Well, if you guess they're going to throw dice, go to the head of the class, because that's what they do. And when Samuel had caused all the tribes of Israel come near, the tribe of Benjamin was chosen by lot. That means dice. He's like walking down Judah. No, not you. Ooh, snake eyes. No, not you, Ephraim. Going out. Oh, look, Benjamin. Yep, that's it. Seven. There you go. Lucky number seven. And then they take the okay, everybody's off the stage. We're Benjamin. We're going to divide up in clans. They do it again. And then when they get the clan, they do it again with the families. And they do the families, they do it again to see which son of the family. And all this goes on. And, I mean, God's just messing with them now, right? Because he controls everything. He can control dice. And when it's all done, they find out, okay, so our king is a guy named Saul, son of Kish, from the tribe of Benjamin. And they're looking around, and there's no Saul. Because as he's watching this take place, and watching it go, and first his tribe gets chosen, he says, this is going to happen. They're going to try to make me king. And he does not feel ready for this. He's completely unqualified. He's scared to death, and he runs and he hides in a coat rack. The guy's like 7 foot tall. Exactly how does he think he's going to hide? I don't know. But he hides, and looking around says, where's Saul? And of course, God rats him out. He says, well, he's over there. He's right there. See those big feet coming out? That's where he is. He's hidden among the equipment, and they ran and brought him from there. And when he stood among the people, he was taller than any of the people from his shoulders up. And Samuel said to the people, do you see him whom the Lord has chosen? There is no one like him among all the people. And all the people shouted and said, long live the king. Yeah, this is the guy we want. Because they're choosing him completely by appearance. God gave them exactly what they asked for. Not what they needed, but exactly what they asked for. And because God is fair, he gave Saul everything he needed to be successful. He put a calling on his life. He gave him an anointing. He gave him the Holy Spirit. He gave him everything he needed to be successful. All he had to do is walk the way the Lord said. And he would have been a successful king. See, man's idea of a king looks like that. I don't know if you guys saw the TV show, or I don't know if you call them TV shows anymore, on Amazon called Reacher. So Reacher's the lead of it. He's supposed to be a really big and strong guy, and this is the guy that got to play him, Lady Settle Down. So anyway, but this is him. Now, he's about 6'7". I'm not. I'm 6'2". But as a guy who's 6'2" and gets pictures made all the time with people, I know what he's doing here. What he's actually done is he's put 1 foot behind him, and he's leaning back like this. He's taken 2 inches off his height. She's wearing 4-inch heels. This poor guy doesn't get to wear heels. So this is the difference in height. That's huge. And if you ever watch the show, it's really funny because he's this district attorney or something, and he's threatening him. He walks up to him, you know. He's like, I'm going to get you. You know, it's like so silly in some ways. This guy's just like, okay, whatever. Right? But this is what we want. This is what we want. This is our idea of a king. This is who we want. So, God gave them what they wanted, not what they needed. But I want to show you that it starts off okay. Actually, what is Saul's response? It's basically, who, me? Oh, no. And it's that way when Samuel first tells him he's going to be king. And it's that way when he sees the inevitability of him being chosen through the dice. He goes and runs it. No, you guys cannot meet me. No, I can't do this. I can't do this. Can I just say that's an exactly appropriate response when God calls you into ministry? Ask me how I know. That was my response. Not me. Somebody else, not me. I don't want to do that. That sounds hard. I don't want to do that. I'm not qualified. I can't do it. I don't think so. I really don't think I should be doing that. But that's not unique. We see this happen all throughout the Bible. Gideon, great example of this. Gideon cracks me up. Gideon's a coward. He's hiding in a pit trying to make bread because the Midianites keep attacking. He's in this pit, and an angel of the Lord shows up. And Gideon's kind of like, could you like move? I'm trying not to call attention to myself. You're bright. You know, can you somewhere? And the angel of the Lord says this to him. Hey there, mighty warrior. And he's not being sarcastic. That's not irony. He's saying, hi, mighty warrior. And he looks up at him and says, are you kidding me right now, mighty warrior? And he says, no, but while you're here, pardon me. Let me ask you a question. You're from heaven. Let me ask you a question. Why have you deserted us? Midianites are killing us. They're taking everything. Every time we plant a crop, they come in and steal it. Why are you, if you're from heaven, why have you deserted us? In fact, our ancestors told us about how you beat the Egyptians and all that, but I'm seeing none of that. You have abandoned us. You've given us over into the hands of Midian, and I think you should do something about it. I don't know why you call me a mighty warrior. You should get together with the Lord and get some kind of an army together and take care of this problem. And he says, no, you're going to go in the strength you have, and you're going to save Israel. You wanted me to do something? I am doing it. I'm sending you. And they go, oh, whoa, no. I did not ask for that. Pardon me, Lord. How can I save him? Watch what he says. My clan's the weakest in Manasseh, and I'm the least of my family. Sounds a lot like Saul. This is the common excuse. He says, no, it's okay, because I'm going to be with you, and you will strike down all the Midianites, because I'm going to be with you. It's going to take Gideon a while to learn what this sentence means. You plus God makes a majority. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter who you are, how weak you are. You've got to realize that with God, you're okay. Without him, you're in trouble, but with God, you're good.
Just so you understand, right now, out there on your own, your life expectancy is like here. With me, it's here. Without me, here. With me, without me. With me, without me. So,
it's kind of how we have to learn. Here, I get it, without God, but with God, without God. And that's what he's doing. Second thing is that he anoints him for ministry. He doesn't say you're going to be king. He said, I'm going to anoint you. I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. I'm going to give you anointing of the Holy Spirit, which, by the way, was very unique in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit's available to all of us today, but the Old Testament, you don't see it very much. Few people. I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit that does everything you need. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard this before. I used to believe this. God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. I used to believe this. And by the way, when you're a preacher, when you're a pastor who starts a new church and you don't have a divinity degree, you lean on this verse a lot. But this isn't actually a verse. Some guy just said it once. It sounds cool, so people repeat it. I actually think it's wrong now. I used to believe entirely in that, but I don't think it gives God credit for what he does. God doesn't call the unqualified. It's just what God wants done. He sees clearly he needs different qualities than we think matter. We see this throughout the Bible, but God looks for qualities that often we cannot see and then don't value. Remember Moses? Sitting in front of God. God says, okay, I'm going to send you back to Egypt, the place they tried to kill you. And Moses, okay. And I'm going to have you lead the people out. He says, yeah, they won't even listen to me, Lord. Forget Pharaoh. We'll get to him in a minute. Israel is not going to follow me. They wouldn't follow me 40 years ago when I tried to lead a revolt. They wouldn't follow me then. What makes you think they're going to follow me now, 40 years later? They're not going to follow me. And God asks him this question. What's that in your hand? He says, the shepherd's staff. See, here's the thing. Moses was thinking the way we think. Look, there's slaves over there, right? Well, there's three ways we can get slaves out. You can buy them if you have enough money. They're for sale. They're slaves. He doesn't have any money in his hand. Or you can negotiate. We just saw this happen going on, what's going on in Ukraine and Russia, right? They negotiate the release of an American Marine. You can, as an envoy, negotiate for their release. But Moses is not holding an envoy's badge in his hand. Or finally, if you're strong enough, you can go take them. You can have an army go in, wipe Egypt out, take Israel out of it. But Moses did not have a sword in his hand. Everything he thinks he needed to get them out, he didn't have. But what he had was a shepherd's staff, because God says, I don't need a warrior. I don't need money. I don't need an envoy. I need somebody whose heart's committed to me and who knows how to be a shepherd. So Moses was absolutely fully qualified to be a shepherd. He'd been doing it for 40 years. He was really good at it by now. And so God does this, but Moses didn't know what he was calling him to do. The problem is we have an idea of what qualifies somebody. And then we see all these people who are disqualified, but God doesn't see that at all. One more example of this. This is great. This is from the New Testament. So Jesus has gone back to heaven. Everybody's gathered in the upper room, and they're waiting for the Holy Spirit to come. But the Holy Spirit hasn't come. So they do what we all do. Man, what are we doing wrong? We must be doing something wrong. God hasn't come. He said he'd come, and the Spirit's supposed to move, and it hasn't moved. Must be something we're doing wrong. So they think about it. And Peter comes up with the answer. And he stands up, I have it. So first of all, you all know Judas isn't here anymore. That was okay. That was prophesied. We knew that was going to happen. He was counted among our number. That was actually prophesied. But he goes on, he says, however, it is written in the book of Psalms, may another take his place of leadership. He pulls a verse out of Scripture. I love it. It's what all pastors do. We have an idea, and we will go find Scripture to support it. So there's this scripture. So therefore, it's going to be necessary for us to replace him. That's why the Holy Spirit is not here yet. We don't have 12 apostles. We have to have 12. We only have 11. So we need to pick somebody. And we thought about it. We put our heads together. And we have exactly, listen now, this is important. And we have exactly the qualifications. He's going to have to be someone who's been with us the whole time. He was going to have to be there from the beginning of baptism until Jesus was taken up from us. That's who we need. And so they have this simple job description. With us the whole time, living among us now, knew John the Baptist, saw Jesus taken to heaven. Hey, that's pretty good, I think. That's pretty good. Kind of scriptural in a way. Makes sense. He has to be one of us, right? He has to be an apostle. So this is who we have to be. So they gathered up all the people. They looked at them. At least they're not casting lots, right? They're actually putting some kind of a thought into this. And they come up with two people, two men, Joseph and Matthias. And they prayed, Lord, you know everyone's heart, so you need to show us which of these two you've chosen to take over this important apostolic ministry, which Judas left. We need you to help us, Lord. How does God show them who to pick? If you guessed casting dice, go to the head of the class. I'm not kidding you. This is what they do. Then they cast lots. Apostle Peter, come on. Lord needs a new disciple. Ah! And it falls to Matthias. And he says, oh, the dice says it's you, Matthias. Must be you. And so he was added to the 11 apostles. Have you ever heard of the apostle Matthias in your life? No. You know why? His name is never mentioned again in the book of Acts. Do you know why? Because God had already picked his apostle. Unfortunately for them, he doesn't fit any of these qualifications. The guy God had picked is a guy who's currently named Saul, interestingly enough, but God's going to change his name to Paul. He was not with them the whole time. He was not living among them. In fact, he was gathering up an army to come persecute them because he was a Pharisee. He never met John the Baptist, and he never, ever met Jesus Christ in person. He was not there with them when Jesus Christ was taken up. None of these qualifications. None of them. But that's who God picked. Saul of Tarsus was totally unqualified. Not only does he not fit any of these, how about this? Bless his heart, he couldn't preach. The Apostle Paul was a cruddy preacher. I'm not just saying this because I heard him preach one time. I'm saying this because this is what he says. He says this. He says, they say about me, his letters are weighty and strong, but his personal presence is unimpressive and his speech is contemptible. Now, I've preached some bad sermons in my day. I know. I know every one of them because she tells me on the way home. It's 2 miles to my house, the longest ride of my day. But even Victoria has never said, that sermon today, pretty contemptible, I got to say. I might be unimpressive, but I've never preached a contemptible sermon that I'm aware of. Paul says, this is what they say about his sermons. Now, why in the world would God pick him? It seems like Matthias is much better, but you see, God didn't need a preacher. He already had Peter. Peter was really good. I don't need that. What he needed was a scholar who could draw connections that nobody else could draw and then write them down. Where would our church be if Paul hadn't written letters? See, I think if Paul was a great preacher, he wouldn't have been spending his time writing letters. He would have been spending his time preaching. We have a couple letters of Peter, and they're short. We have our New Testament basically written. Every foundation part of our church and every church, was written through the letters of the Apostle Paul. God said, you guys don't know what I need. I need a guy whose heart's going to be committed to mine. And yeah, it's not yet, but it will be. And I need him to be a scholar. I need him to write this down. I need a great letter writer. I don't need another preacher. See, God doesn't call the unqualified. It's just his qualifications are different than ours, which means he might be calling you to some kind of a ministry that makes no sense to you because you don't see it the way he sees it. And usually it doesn't make sense to us. Again, ask me how I know. So the anointing is one of the most mistaught things in the church today. And let me just say right up front, if you ever hear a preacher say, and the scriptures say this, touch not God's anointed, run fast and run far from that church. Because there is a teaching in this church that preachers who have been anointed by God are not to be questioned by anybody for anything they do. That is absolutely not what the anointing is about. It is a misappropriation of a verse that we're actually going to get to later in the series. Here's the purpose of the anointing. It breaks bondage because, believe me, we all are chains that keep us from doing God's will. He'll break that. It will teach you what you need to know to do your ministry, and it'll give God's grace for you as you learn. That's what it's done. So quickly, if I can, through these scriptures in Isaiah, it shall come to pass in the day that his burden will be taken away from your shoulders, his yoke from your neck. I'm going to take it away, the burden that you're feeling, because you're bound up in sin. And the yoke from your neck, and then the yoke will be destroyed because of the anointing oil. He's going to set you free because of the anointing oil. And then later, we see this in 1 John, the Apostle John writing, the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things. The Holy Spirit knows what you need. He knows exactly what you need, and he will teach you. And it is true, and it's not a lie, and it's just as it has been taught to you, you will abide in him. So he's saying the anointing is going to teach you and give you what you need in order to do your ministry. When Paul, who is the most educated person in the New Testament, comes before people, he says, look, I didn't come with you from teachings of men. I came to you with the teaching of the Holy Spirit. That's what matters. Now, you're learning, and when you learn, you make mistakes. And that's the grace that the anointing gives us. I mean, to put it crassly, do I think that I am anointed to be the head pastor of Spirit Chapel? Yes. What does that anointing mean? It means that even when I suck, my sermons don't have to. That's what that means. It means that I can come and counsel somebody in marriage after Victoria and I have been fighting for 3 hours over something stupid and still bless them with proper counseling because his grace takes over. Of course, I can't just live for sin, but I'm saying God takes care of it. He's not going to be stopped from doing the ministry work by my failings. That's the anointing. That doesn't make me special. It just means that this is what I have been brought to. It doesn't make me special. It simply makes the ministry effective because God wants the ministry to be effective. That's it. And by the way, some of you are involved in ministry in this church and out of this church. Same thing. And your ministry, no more or less important than my ministry. We're all working for the same king. That's the whole point of it. So the other thing we have to understand is this. Your ministry through the anointing, if you have a calling on you to do something, and this can be something, you can have a calling on your life to pray for somebody faithfully every night. That's a calling. And it'll get hard at times. That's a calling. God can put a calling on your life for that. You can have a calling on your life to bring peace to your family. You can have a calling on your life to bring God into the workplace. You can have all kinds of callings that God wants to do with you. And if you want to know if it's God, probably it is. If your first question was, who, me? That's probably a good sign from God. Beware of the ministry that you want to do, that you think you're perfectly suited for. Beware of that one. That one could be a problem. Okay, your ministry of the hour will change you. This is what Paul writes. We all behold as a mirror the glory of the Lord, and we're being transformed into the same image from glory to glory by the Spirit of the Lord. The Holy Spirit's trying to transform you, and that is why the devil must stop you. Next week, we're going to see how the devil gets to Saul. And it's a shame because he has everything there, everything he needs. But he won't be effective because he doesn't follow the path. The devil will try to stop you too. We pray hard for everybody in ministry. Everybody who ever takes over the kids' ministry, we've seen them all attacked. We've seen many fall away from the Lord because God doesn't want the kids being taught about him. If you think of a ministry of prayer, oh, will you be attacked? Last thing the devil wants is prayer effective in this church or in this world. The devil must stop you. Which is why, this is the last verse I'm going to show you, I promise you, last verse. Above all else, guard your heart. For everything you do flows from your heart. The devil will get to Saul's heart, and then it's over. Would you all please pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you that you have equipped people to do your ministry. Because we're not good at this stuff. You are the Lord. And we pray that you will teach us to be patient and teach us to hear your calling, to walk the way you send us, to take the anointing with gratitude, and to do your work in Jesus' name.